everyone, I'm Kirti from Kirti Institute and I'm presenting masterclass on OET writing subtest. I promise you that in this lesson, I'm going to give you the information that will help you to boost your understanding regarding the OET writing subtest, no matter how many times you have appeared for OET previously. So stay tuned with me till the end. In this lesson, I'm going to include the basic information about OET, the hospital admission system in Western countries, time management, letter format, and some frequently asked questions about OET. So let's begin. First of all, let's understand the general instructions about OET writing subtest. OET writing is a profession specific. The case notes will be given to you, followed by the writing task. Based on the case notes and writing task, you have to write a formal case notes, that means formal letter. Types of letters are referral, transfer, discharge, or information letter. If you are a doctor or a nurse, you do not need to worry about the fourth type of letter, and that is information or advice letter. Body of the letter should be approximately 180 to 200 words, but do not worry because OET is not that strict about the word count. You can write up to 220 or 170. That's fine. It depends on the case notes. Allocated time is total 45 minutes, out of which 5 minutes of reading time and 40 minutes of writing time. So before we proceed, first of all, we will understand about the hospital admission process in the Western countries, because I personally believe that the admission process differs from country to country. I'm from India, and here in India, we as a patient can directly admitted into the multi-super specialty hospitals. There we can get treatment by the specialist and we have to do follow-up with the same doctors. But in Western countries, the process is different. So before to improve your level of understanding, it is necessary to understand the hospital admission process. So let's begin. At home, when patient gets admitted or when patient gets sick, he has to first visit the community health center or public health center, where he will be treated by general practitioner as well as the community health nurse or district health nurse. If patient is getting better, he will get discharged back to the home and will do follow-up with the same GP or the community health nurse, district health nurse, or home care nurse based on the patient's requirements. But if patient cannot be treated at initial level or at primary level, then the GP or community health nurse will write a letter to the specialist doctor or the registered nurse who will be working into the hospital in the multi-super specialty hospitals. So here the patient will get the specialized care or specific care, advanced care we can say. And if patient is getting cure, then he will be again be transferred to the home. Okay, he will be discharged to the home, but ultimately patient will be under the supervision of the GP or community health nurse, home care nurse, based on the patient's requirements again. But if the patient cannot be treated at hospital levels also, or after receiving the specific care, patient still requires some minor cares or some specific care like physiotherapy or daily dressing. So based on that, the patient will be transferred further to the other medical specialist. And then patient might be at home and receiving the care from the specialist, or patient will be into the hospital and will receive the treatment by other specialists. So when you receive a letter, identify your position into this circle. Whether you are a community health nurse, or whether you are providing care at primary level, or you are registered nurse who will be working into the specialist care. Because when you will read the first sentence, you are a registered nurse looking after this patient, that means you are providing some specific care to the patient, and patient will be getting discharged who will be under the supervision of someone else. Okay, so your position will help you to understand which type of patient you are going to receive or what kind of treatment might be given to the patient. So this circle is, that's why necessary to understand, to identify your role in the task and the patient's expected treatment from the specialist or from the GP or from whosoever you are waiting. So this was the purpose of explaining, because I want you to understand the case notes from the first sentence you read. From the writing task, when you are reading that, write a letter to the endocrinologist. And if you are a doctor, then you should understand that you must be GP looking after the patient. And now you will write to the endocrinologist to receive the specialist care, which relates to the endocrinologist. Okay, so this to develop your understanding about the case notes, I want you to understand this circle first. Okay, I hope this everything is clear now. Now let's move on to time management. How to manage your time of 45 minutes. So 5 minutes of reading time will be given to you, and you are going to identify four main things. Let's see what kind of writing task you may receive. Using the information given in the case notes, write a referral letter to Dr. Robson, an allergist, to identify Mr. Riedel's allergens and further management. So from this type of information, you are going to identify four main things. Number one is which type of letter you are writing. So here you can see the type of letter is referral, right? Then to whom you are writing. To whom means I don't want to know the name of the person. I want to know what is the specialty of that person. So here is an allergist. So to whom I am writing? Allergist. Now I should be aware that what are the roles and responsibilities of the allergist. Okay, he will be responsible to identify the causative organisms for any specific allergy. He can prescribe some specific investigations to rule out allergies, or he can treat the allergies which is already known in a specialized manner with a specific treatment. Okay, so to whom I am writing, and I also should connect what are the roles and responsibilities of that particular specialty, and what all things that the person can do. Then third one is purpose of writing a letter. So here the purpose is clearly mentioned, to identify Mr. Riedel's allergens and further management. So this is my purpose. Okay, why I'm writing. And the fourth thing is patient is known or unknown. Sometimes you are here in this place only, they will give you the address. Okay, to whom you are writing, to Dr. Robson. So this allergist's address would be given wherever he is working, that hospital's address will be given. So if the address relates with the patient's address, okay, then it might be the known case. If you're writing to the patient's GP, right? So patient's address and GP's address will be from the same place. So that says that patient is known. GP is probably known to the patient, also known as FD, family doctor. So known to the patient. You are receiving the patient from the nursing home and you are sending patient back to the nursing home. So the patient is known. In that case, it will be written, write a letter to the patient's home care nurse or patient's GP. So patient's GP, that little apostrophe S changes the entire meaning, that patient is known. And still you will have to confirm while reading the case notes. Okay, so these four things you are going to identify while reading the writing task. And then you can start reading the case notes with understanding. When you read the case notes for the first time, just read it as a story. Don't try to think about the selection. You know that to whom you are writing and what is the purpose, that things you keep in mind and just start reading the case notes and identify the key features. Okay, just identify the what kind of patient you have received, what are the problems. Okay, those questions are coming in the next slides. So let's move on. So this is how you should utilize your 5 minutes. In the next 40 minutes, you have to do the selection of the case notes. Now you know to whom you are writing, what is the purpose. Based on that, you have already read the case notes. Now you utilize your time for the selection of the case notes. You read earlier case notes and now you start reading from the beginning again and put the tick mark for the information that you are going to select. Make no marks for the information that you are not going to include. and put question mark for the information that makes you confused whether to include or not. Okay, that you will confirm during the planning time. So what exactly you should do during this 40 minutes, you should select the case notes for first 5 minutes. Okay, and ask yourself these 6 questions to improve your understanding. Like the first question is, where are you working? So based on the previous understanding, like when we learn about the hospital admission system, at that time we learned that where I'm working. If I'm registered nurse, I might be writing to the GP or community health nurse or home care nurse or the physiotherapist. If I'm working as a community health nurse, I might be writing a letter to the doctor, the specialist doctor or other doctors based on or any registered nurse based on the patient's requirements. So where are you working? Second question is from where you received the patient. So if where are you working and from where you received the patient are same place, okay, then patient is known. So these questions will help you to understand whether patient is known or unknown to you. Number 3 is what is or are the problems of the patient. Now, problem doesn't mean the diagnosis. Okay, for example, the patient is diagnosed as a diabetes mellitus, but the current problem might be bed sore and you are writing for the treatment of the bed sore. So that main medical issue you should be aware of. So while reading the case notes, you should understand what is or are the current problems of the patient for which you are referring to someone. Okay, so identify the main problems or the current problems of your patient. How have you treated? Means when patient was under your care, what kind of treatment or care you have provided to the patient to treat particular symptoms or disease condition or whatever patient's concern was? Where are you referring the patient? Okay, and why? If you have provided this much treatment, then why I'm referring the patient to someone? What are the purposes behind that? What kind of treatment or care I'm expecting from that person? That all things you should understand. So while practicing at home, you should give practice to yourself to ask these 6 questions before you appear for your final test so that your actual level of thinking will be advance. So when you will sit for the real test, you will be habitual of thinking all these things and you will not need to ask these questions to yourself. Okay, so identify the main features, the key features, and understand the case notes entirely because each and every case notes differs from each other. So what kind of case is given to you that you should understand properly? Then you can spend 5 minutes for planning. You have selected case notes. Based on that, you should plan that I have this many information. Okay, for example, I have 4 or 5 information to write in one paragraph. Then if I will separate this information from previous paragraph, it makes sense. So if you have 5 information in one paragraph, you should think that how can I organize this 5 information so that it will make a logical story and it will be easy for the reader to understand. In many students' case notes or later, I have seen that first of all, you are writing about patient's treatment. Then you are writing about family history, like father is known case of cardiac disease. Again, you are connecting with patients presenting complaints. So this father's history interrupts your story, right? So you should think before you write that how I should organize this information to make the things logical and professional. Okay, so planning is must do thing. Okay, otherwise at the end, you may feel that I would have performed much better than how I did today. Okay, so we don't want that to happen. Okay, so plan, always plan. If you are doing proper practice, you will be habitual to organize or you will be expert to organize your introduction paragraph and your final recommendation paragraph. But you may get confused about your body paragraphs where you will need to think whether this letter should be organized chronologically or as per the degree of importance or how can I gather the information and write, how can I organize or do proper paragraphing. Every damn thing you should think before you start writing. So you can take 5 minutes for this, then start writing. Okay, because your all ideas are clear. You know what to write where. So now you are just going to form the sentences into the English. Okay, you have all the points where to write what. So start writing now. And if everything is clear, it won't take more than 25 minutes to complete your writings. Okay, so at the end, you will have 5 minutes for proofreading. And you will make sure that whatever mistakes you have done during your practice time, whatever corrections you used to get from your experts, those mistakes you have not repeated into your real exam. Okay, so proofreading is also required. So spend at least 2 minutes to have proofreading. Okay, so this is how you should utilize your time. So in this letter, till now, we learned about hospital admission process, general instructions, time management, and now we are moving towards letter format. So let's see the letter format. You should start writing everything from the left-hand side of your letter. Okay, start writing from the date. Then you should leave one line, then write recipient's name. If the person's name is given to whom you are writing, that name should be written here. Then write the profession that must be given into the task. So write that person's profession. Then write clinic or hospital's name where you are referring your patient. And then the address. Again, leave one line and write RE line, that is reference, patient's name with age. Again, leave one line, write salutation mark, that is dear sir or madam, with comma, if name is not given into the task. But if you are already aware of the patient's name, then you should start with dear Dr. Robert. Okay, dear Doctor is a title and Robert is a family name. So that is how you should write salutation. You can write in either way. You can write salutation first and then the patient's name and age, or you can write patient's name and age first and then the solution. Same for the date. You can write date either at the top of the letter and that will be the date of your exam, or you can write that date after the address. It depends on you. Wherever you feel comfortable, you can write, but make sure every time you are writing at one particular place while practicing so that you will not have any chance to forget to write the date. Okay, so write at any one particular place. After salutation, you will start writing your introduction, and from here your word count will be started and it should be counted till your recommendation paragraph. Word count will not include your closing phrase and sign off yours, name and designation. Okay, so write your introduction paragraph, then body paragraphs, then recommendation paragraphs. Leave one line between each paragraph. Do not leave half line to show your paragraphing. Start everything from the margin itself. There is no margin into the real booklet, answer booklet, but start writing from one particular line. Okay, it should not be in a haphazard manner. It should look impressive to the examiner when they open your letter and when they start reading. Okay, so leave one line between each paragraph. Then write a closing phrase, which is a formality. It must be done into the formal letter. You can write anything like, please feel free to contact me with any queries. Or you can write, should you have any requirements, please feel free to contact me. Should you have any queries, please feel free to contact me. Then you should sign off, which is very important to sign off properly. You can write sign off with either yours sincerely or yours faithfully. Now, when to write sincerely and when to write faithfully and why? So first thing, when you know the recipient, okay, like here recipient's name is given, that means I know that person by name. So I will close with yours sincerely because I know the person, and sincerely shows the language of semi-formal language. Okay, it is a sincerely is a semi-formal language. So suppose you know me by my name, okay, you might be knowing me by attending my lectures repeatedly, so you know who I am. Okay, so you are known to me. So if you are writing an email or letter to me, you will close with yours sincerely because you know me, but my relationship is not friendly. Okay, it is semi-formal. So you will close with sincerely. This is something out of OET, but will be very helpful to you when you reach your real destiny. Okay, so you can remember like this: S for sincerely, S for semi-formal, and S for surname. Surname is a family name. So when you start writing with surname, that is family name, Dear Dr. Robert, you will close with yours sincerely. Okay, so this is how you can remember. But suppose you are writing a letter to the OET Melbourne main office, do you know who is going to receive your letter? Nobody knows. So this is called pure formal relationship. You are unknown to the person, and that's why you're starting your letter with Dear Sir or Madam, and you should close with yours faithfully. And faithfully shows pure formal language. This is the difference why you should close with sincerely or faithfully. So F for formal, F for faithfully. S for surname, S for sincerely. This is how you can remember and you can understand the reason for writing or closing with yours sincerely or faithfully. Then you should put comma and leave one line. Ideally, this space is for making your signature. But this is your test, so your original signature is not required. But you are going to leave one line to show the space for making your signature. Then write your name only if given into the task. For example, at the beginning of the case notes, it is written that you are a registered nurse, Mrs. Sarina Chai, looking for this patient. So for that day, your name is Sarina Chai and you should close with that name. Okay, please don't make mistake to write your own name. It is not required. So close with the name only if given in the task. Otherwise, don't write any name. Just close it with your designation. Okay, yours sincerely or faithfully, comma, and then write your designation, registered nurse or general practitioner or endocrinologist or whatsoever your specialty or your profession is. Now let's see the right hand side of this page. Here you can start writing the date like 13 space June space 2020. This is the ideal way of writing the today's date in the real letter. Okay. Dr. James Robert, if name is given in the task, the allergist, which is the profession, the Evangeline Booth Hospital, that is name of the hospital, Central Hospital, Old Town 4101 or 41001. So this is the pin code number and that also should be written into the next line. Again, lay one line and write Dear Dr. Robert, okay, if the name is given. If not given, no worries, Dear Sir / Madam, comma. That is how you can write. Then referring Mr. Adam Middleton, comma, and 85 year old. In the last slide, I will give you the information regarding how to write age and date. So please stay tuned till then. Now, after referring the patient or after mentioning the RE line, that is patient's name and age, you should again leave one line and start writing your introduction paragraph. When you write your introduction paragraph, make sure you are including three main things. The first is patient's name, the second is patient's current medical issue, and third is why are you writing a letter. Clear purpose of writing a letter must be mentioned into the introduction paragraph, because just for writing a purpose, you are going to get 3 marks. And the writing assessment criteria says that purpose should be immediately apparent into the task. That means when you are writing into the introduction, it should be in a one sentence you should mention. Okay, not a detail. You are just going to mention the purpose into the introduction paragraph. And the second point of assessment criteria for purpose says that it should be sufficiently expanded into the course of the letter. That means you should write the purpose into the introduction paragraph as a statement, and it should be elaborated or explained into the body paragraphs. Okay, and for this you are going to get 3 marks, 3 bands. Okay, so make sure you don't forget to write your purpose into the introduction paragraph. That's it about introduction. Then move to your body paragraphs. Okay, you can write either chronologically or as per the degree of importance, depends purely on the case notes that is given to you. And then you should write your recommendation paragraph. Now, what is recommendations paragraph? Recommendation means what you want the reader to do. Okay, why are you writing a letter? All those requests should be written into the last paragraph as a request, not as a statement. Patient requires daily dressing is a statement. Kindly provide daily dressings to the patient is a request. Okay, so we are going to write all the requests or recommendations into the last body paragraph. And then you should write your closing phrase. In the recommendations paragraph, you also need to inform some information for which the reader is not going to do anything but necessary to inform. For example, if you are writing to the community health nurse and patient requires daily dressing, then you will write, kindly provide daily dressings to the patient. But it is also important for you to inform her that the patient has follow-up visit next week, right? So for such kind of information, you can use the connectors like please note he has follow-up visit on so and so date, or you can join with importantly, patient has follow-up visit after a week. Okay, so the information for which the recipient is not direct care provider but still necessary for to inform the information to the reader, such kind of information you can connect with please note or importantly if required. Then you should write your last formality closing phrase. Please feel free to contact me with any queries, and yours sincerely or faithfully, that we have already discussed. Then leave one line, write your name only if given into the task, and then the profession. Okay, so this is how you should arrange your format. Now, let me explain you one important thing. You should manage your time as I have discussed earlier. But unfortunately, if you came across the situation where only last 5 minutes are left and you started feeling that I am not going to finish my letter, okay, you are afraid that you are running short of time and you won't be able to finish your letter, what ideally you should do, suppose you must be writing your last paragraph at the time, leave some space, okay, to complete that paragraph and move to the formality. Please feel free to contact me with any queries. Yours sincerely, faithfully, leave one line and write your profession. And then if your time permits, go back to the last paragraph and complete those phrases, your remaining sentences. The reason is that you are maintaining the format which is expected by the examiner. So here you will be less penalized compared to that letter where you leave incomplete. Okay, so if only 5 minutes are left and you want to cover the format, leave some space, and that might be the information like follow-up visit or have coordination with other specialists. So if you are missing 1 point or 2 points, you will be less penalized compared to the letter where you are unable to complete. Okay, so this is how you can utilize your last 5 minutes if you are running short by time. Now let's see the frequently asked questions, and the first question is how to write dates. So there are two ways of writing dates in the OET, and the first format says 21 space May space 2020. Okay, this way of date should be written at the top of the letter where you are going to write about the today's date. But if you need to write the dates into the body paragraphs, use this second format, 21/05/2020. And the reason is that if you're writing the date in full in the body paragraphs, then it will be considered as 3 words. And it is also time consuming for the examiner to read and understand when exactly the incidence has happened, how much time it has taken, if repeated dates are there or several dates are there. Okay, so use the slash format, which is easy to understand and easy to write. Okay, so that is what you can do. Then writing the age. So here you can write, when you're using the hyphen format, 85 hyphen year hyphen old, then don't forget to write article A or N, because here year is taken, 85 year old is taken as an adjective. Okay, so you should write here 85. So 85 starts with the vowel sound, 85. So you should use article N. N, 85 year old, not years, it is year because you are putting hyphens. Okay, so year old. But if you are writing simply 85 space years space old, you can also write aged 85 years, age colon 85 years. Sometimes they are not giving the age, only date of birth. Don't get afraid. No need to calculate and waste your time. Just write date of birth as it is given in the task. Okay, then the title. Mr. is used for any kind of male person. If your patient is male, whether married or unmarried, you can use Mr. MR. Second, for married women, you can use Mrs. MRS for married women. Miss is used, which is complicated. Miss is used with the woman who don't want to disclose the marital status, including divorcing. If the patient is widower and if the title is not given and you need to choose the title, then write Miss. But if the patient is divorcee and title is given Mrs., write Mrs. only. Okay, so don't get confused. If you need to choose the title, then choose correctly. Now I said Miss is used with a person who don't want to disclose the marital status. So this may include the incidents or the case notes in which you are dealing with the teenager who has given the birth to the child and is unmarried. Okay, unwed mother is giving a birth to the child. So you can understand that although she is a teenager, she cannot be considered as a children now. And she must be in the position where she cannot disclose the marital status. So in certain kind of things, you can use the title Miss. Then DR for doctors, you all are well aware. And no title should be used for the children who is 18 and below. Okay, teenagers are still considered as children. So 18 and below does not require any title. Okay, you can directly address the children by their first name. No need to write master. Okay, please don't make this mistake. Just address the patient who is a child by first name. Okay, one more question that I frequently received from the students is how many paragraphs should be there in the OET writing? There is no any fixed criteria for making paragraphs, how many paragraphs you can write. You can make paragraphing logically. Okay, whenever you think that you are talking about something else very differently, you should write into the next paragraph. Okay, so ideally you should write no more than 5 paragraphs. One will be your introduction paragraph, second, third, and fourth will be your body paragraphs, including recommendations. And fifth one will be your recommendation. First is introduction. Maximum 3 body paragraphs and recommendations paragraphs. So there should not be more than 5 body paragraphs in your letter, ideally. Okay, but still it depends on the case notes that is given to you. And there is no any strict limit of the sentences also, that ma'am, whether I can make only one paragraph only of 3 sentences. Of course you can. Who said that you should have 5 to 6 sentences to make paragraph? Not required. It purely depends on the type of letter and the type of information that you have selected and organized. Okay, so I hope I have made a lot of things clear for you, and I wish you all the best. You can now start preparing for OET, and I will be back with the task to explain in front of you all. I tried to organize a live meeting, but unfortunately because of overload on the internet and other issues, I could not connect. So I have decided to give you the recorded meetings so that you can utilize and you can play this audio as many times, video and audio as many times as you want. Okay, so I wish you all the best. Prepare for your test, and if you require any kind of help, then please feel free to contact me. Okay, till then, bye. Have a good day. and stay safe and stay tuned with me. Bye bye.